No extra.
Minus two.
1 minute extra.
Minus two.
He has taken 1 minute extra.
Minus two.
That's good, sir.
Good, good, good. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, Chairman, sir. This is a very important issue that is being discussed and is very vital to our country's future. लेकिन मैं मेरी बात कहने से पहले एक बात कह दूँ, प्रशंसा बहुत हो रही है हमारी विदेश मंत्री जी की, जिसके साथ मैं भी जुड़ना चाहता हूँ और वो काबिल है इस प्रशंसा की। लेकिन मेरी एक शिकायत है सरकार, और शिकायत ये है कि विदेश नीति भी यही तय करे प्रधानमंत्री के ऑफिस क्यों करती है। हाँ, तो अब देश थोड़ा और बेहतर देश की व्यवस्था होगी। हमारी निवेदन है आपसे कि जिस तरीके से आप हैंडल करते हैं अपने देश के लोगों को वापस लाने में, जिस इंसानियत और विनम्रता की आपके पहचान है, उसी के साथ साथ विदेश नीति भी तय होती तो देश का भलाई होता। ये हमारी जी ये बात कहते हैं सर, सुनने के लिए बैठे सर। बेसिकली वी आर डिस्कसिंग इंडियाज़ फॉरेन पॉलिसी एट अ वेरी क्रिटिकल टाइम, एंड फॉरेन पॉलिसी इज ऑल ऑफ अस नो सर is essentially an extension of your domestic policy. Now, what is in India's interest, that should dominate what should be the foreign policy at any point of time. And over a period through our history, historically we have evolved the position that India's foreign policy essentially has to be an independent foreign policy that will protect our interests, and that should be the topmost priority. And hence, there was a time when we led the world, or the developing world, as the leaders of the non-aligned movement. There was a time when our voice as an independent voice in the International Committee of Nations was heard with great deal of respect, and there are times when we influence the global policy positions on various issues, including our then Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi's nuclear disarmament that's still pending before the United Nations General Assembly. Total abolition of all nuclear weapons, India was taking the lead. Today, unfortunately, what has happened is, I think, a very serious rupture of this entire policy orientation. Yes, the world has changed since then. The Cold War has ended, and then you had a different correlation of power and forces in the international arena. So certain shifts the governments of India had taken in those times, and in these shifts, the basic question is, where does our interest lie? Does it lie in the pursuit of an independent foreign policy, or does it lie in the pursuit of being aligned with some power or the other? In the whole world situation that was emerging and still continuing today, the battle between what I'll call unipolarity under the leadership of the United States of America, or a multipolarity, which is what the natural tendency in the world is and should have been after the end of the Cold War, the choice is, where do we align ourselves with? With the unipolarity led by the USA, or the multipolarity that has various poles in which we can define our interests? Unfortunately, my charge against this government is that we have lock, stock and barrel moved towards this whole position of a unipolarity. And that, in my opinion, is not in India's interest. And therefore, sir, by saying this, I also want to make the point, India's security, India's international border security, India's sovereignty, these are paramount. The defense of this is non-negotiable. Whoever be the one who would try to violate our security and sovereignty, India must be in a position to defend. And as I said, on that there can be no compromise. And we, I mean, all of us are along with that. But having said this, does joining the unipolarity camp led by the USA in terms of foreign policy in India's interest? When this whole battle between unipolarity and multipolarity was happening, yes, we have seen the earlier governments also in India take up positions which we had thoroughly disagreed. You moved into a strategic partnership with the USA under the UPA government. Then you went on to make the Indo-US nuclear deal, which led to a rupture in the USA, and our support had to be withdrawn because that was not part of the common minimum program that we had all agreed upon then. But today, sir, looking back, after that Indo-US nuclear deal, after that, what has India achieved, sir? How are you putting your trust in the United States leadership for us to achieve anything? Has there been one extra megawatt of nuclear power added in our country?
Out of that deal.
Subsequent to the deal, was there any transfer of technology that has occurred here from the United States or the so-called elite nuclear club? Have we been permitted to enter the nuclear suppliers group? If today our scientists are able to fire these rockets and satellites and send them to outer space, that is only because of the pride that we all have in our own indigenous talent and our own scientists who have actually made that happen, and not because of any foreign collaboration.
Yes, that's correct.
So now, instead of that.
That is correct.
At the same time, in this battle between unipolarity and multipolarity, we have lauded many instances that the UPA government took. We were responsible and played a vital role for the what was called the IBSA, India, Brazil and South Africa. We played a very important role in extending that to the BRICS, that is India, Brazil, South Africa, including China and Russia. Now, this multipolarity is a natural tendency that the world should move into. But now, in these 3 years, what has India been reduced to? I'm sorry to say that India has been reduced to, from what I can see, as a junior strategic ally of US foreign policy in the world. And the reason I'm saying is the string of agreements that we have signed with the United States of America. 5 times the Prime Minister went there, and the 5th time, what happened that I'll come to later, but after the four times that he went there and the joint statements you find, and one of the things that has been signed, which is actually very worrisome, is what is called the Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement, the LIMAO. And according to this memorandum, sir, we know nothing. We know nothing about what are the conditions of this memorandum. It has not been placed before the Indian Parliament. It has not been discussed here. But in the USA, this has to go for the approval of the US Senate as part of the 2017 National Defense Authorization Act. It has gone there. What is contained in the agreement, we know from their website. We know from what the United States government has put out. And according to what they have put out, what does this say? What does this say, sir? That the major defense partner designation, the statement says, is a status unique to India and brings India to a level at par of that of the United States' closest allies and partners. What does that mean? I'm reading out from the from that report that they have put on. Paragraph E of Section 1292 of that Act says, quotes, mechanisms to verify the security of defense articles, defense services, related technology, such as appropriate cyber security and end-user monitoring agreements, unquote, and that India will align its, quote, export control and procurement regimes with those of the United States, unquote. What greater surrender of sovereignty can there be, sir? And what does this agreement go on to say? That we were talking about India's strategy, sovereignty, security, and said that is non-negotiable. But what does this document say?
On our target.
Quote, defense and security cooperation in India in order to advance, please underline the word advance, United States interests in South Asia and greater Indo-Asia-Pacific regions, unquote. So we are now the junior ally and a subordinate partner of the USA in our neighborhood. This is the last nail in the coffin of our independent foreign policy. And I say this with a heavy heart, that we can see this happening in various initiatives that this government has taken. We see this happening, sir. You say now this alignment with the United States of America has its implications in all the fields. You have them in all the fields. I mean, I don't know. I mean, there's a difference in count. I think you said the Prime Minister went how many times?
No,
world tours.
65.
65. I took it as 56. 56 cheppani inchiki chathi, so I thought it was 56. But not once have we had any statement here in the house. Not once. That's why when I praised the Honorable Foreign Minister, External Affairs Minister, I said she calls the consultative committee sometimes to tell us what happened in this this visit or that visit. But not in the house. That's why I praise you, madam. I want the policy also to come from your office. Now, after all these things have opened up all our domestic avenues. This junior partnership status has led to a shift in your economic policy to the extent that we have virtually made all foreign investment on an automatic route and 100% in almost all sectors. You're privatizing now your railways. You're privatizing Air India. Your defense procurement, the biggest privatization that is happening. And the defense procurement privatization following this treaty that I was quoting. And what is the end result of that, sir? The end result of that, I'm just quoting out what is the actual fact, that in these 3 years, after this government assumed office, in these 3 years, just 1.1 crore of defense FDI has come in. After the fifth visit now to the USA, there's been no foreign investment that has come in till May. The country stood at $1,000 of foreign investment 2016-17. In 2014-15, it was $78,000. Despite all this, what have we done now with this agreement? 49% of all defense production in our country will, through the automatic route, be available for foreign investment. Is that in our interest, sir? Is that in our interest to allow not only USA but any other country to inspect our defense facilities? Our DRDO that produces all these things today is in close collaboration, I'll come to it, as a partner of the defense industry of Israel. Is that in our interest, sir? And this is the question that I'm asking. If you're talking of India's security and of India's thing, and what have we got out of this, the last visit that you went, I mean, the Prime Minister went, the fifth visit. Many my colleagues have said that we have got no assurance on H-1B visas. We have nothing. Only we were assured when the EAM, Foreign Minister, stood up and said, we can also retaliate. There are also so many thousands of US workers here. We can also do that. But whatever that has happened, there's been no assurance on your visas. There's been no assurance on anything that is connected with easing this sort of development with India, and there are more than 5 lakh of our youth today in the IT industry. Sir, Silicon Valley, you must be happy also, Deputy Chairman, sir, that if you go to the Silicon Valley today, officially the USA says the second language in the Silicon Valley is an Indian language. And the year I went, when Stanford invited me, I was very happy because that was my mother tongue, Telugu, they said. Sometimes Malayalam comes. Sometimes, you know, your Kannada comes. But we rule the roost when our youth are today at the forefront of information technology. Much of the profits go to the multinationals. That's a different point. But even there, 5 lakhs of them, today, their continuation there and doing the job is in jeopardy. And then you're trusting the present US president. And may I read out, to you a report that appeared in the Los Angeles Times when President Trump completed 70 days. I'm reading, it's an editorial, what they call the leader. I'm quoting from the Los Angeles Times, quote, "Nothing prepared us for the magnitude of this train." That's how they describe the Donald Trump presidency. I'm continuing with the quotation. "Like millions of other Americans, we clung to a simple hope, a slim hope, that the new president would turn out to be all noise and bluster, or that people around him in the White House would act as a check on his worst instincts, or that he would be sobered and transformed by the awesome responsibilities of office. Instead, 70 some days in, with about 1400 days to go before his term is completed, it is increasingly clear that those hopes were misplaced," unquote. This is Americans. It is their assessment. And we come back here satisfied with an assessment that the US president is going to meet our demands? Are we being realistic, sir? And in this background, what I'm really worried about is this shift not only as a junior partner of the US in world affairs, but it's actually most confirmed about the recent visit to Israel. Now, in the recent visit to Israel, we have signed seven agreements. I would like to know what they are. Though we received a report from the consultative committee, but these seven agreements, without making the traditional joint visit to the Palestinian territories and visiting Ramallah, and with all the statements that have come out in the media of some leakage of some comments that the Prime Minister have made, which are very disparaging to the Palestinians, this is the final nail again in the coffin of our entire independent foreign policy and our solidarity with the Palestinian struggle. This solidarity goes back before we were independent, sir, to what Mahatma Gandhi said during our freedom struggle. If the English can have England, if the French can have France, then Palestinians will have Palestine. Not one word on the illegal occupation of Palestinian lands. You have further cemented our relation as a defense partner. We already were the largest purchaser of arms and defense material from Israel. And that sale to India was what was financing the illegal occupation in Palestine, Palestinian lands. And today, you have virtually given up that entire approach of India standing in world affairs. And to what end? What is the benefit? I've told you what was the benefit of the discussion. The economic policies that you opened up, your demonetization, the way you brought your GST, are all designed to give mega profits to your multinational corporations. What is this entire digital drive that you have done through your demonetization? Who are the digital companies in the world who get these profits, sir? No, after the GST, you pay 18% on every digital transaction as your transaction cost. If 100 rupee travels 1 lakh times, if it's in cash, its value remains 100 rupees. But if it's done through digital transactions 1 lakh times with 18% as your commission, then 18 lakhs of profit is generated for the digital companies when the value continues to remain 100. What are we doing? You are burdening our own people in order to appease this foreign capital, and yet nothing comes into the country. I've quoted the figures to you. Now with this GST, that is, your economic policy is opening up, and today in the world of this capitalist crisis that is continuing for its ninth year now, having started in 2008, in 2008, what is the West looking for? What is America looking for? It's looking for markets, it's looking for cheap resources, and you're opening up India for their benefit so that they can get out of their crisis. Well, our people pay the price. So where is this foreign policy leading us to? One important element of this foreign policy is, what are your relations with your neighbors? Universally accepted. The tenet of India's foreign policy is good neighborly relations. Now, that good neighborly relation, sir, you heard my other colleagues mention about what is happening with the neighboring countries. But look at Nepal. I mean, that is a country with whom, where we've all gone and said, Indians and Nepalese, there's no big brother, small brother. We are twins. We understand each other's pain. We celebrate each other's happiness. Today in that country, what is happening? 22 months, the constitution of Nepal was adopted by the Nepali parliament. They will adopt their constitution. We may have disagreements, we'll take it up diplomatically with them. But that general opinion in Nepal that India is interfering, why does it arise? Why does it arise that India wants a monarchy back in Nepal because that was the only Hindu Rashtra in the whole world? And with this anti-Indian feeling that is growing there, is it in our country's interest? What is happening, sir, with your Bangladesh? The Prime Minister comes, the elections are there, general elections shortly. Some agreements that had to be done, or what you assured them earlier, why you assured them, etc., that's the governmental business. But that not done, any dissatisfaction there growth of anti-India feelings in the run-up to their elections. That is not in India's interest. Pakistan, of course, all of us know. Yesterday, I'm surprised, madam. I hope you'll answer that the High Commissioner said that both the NSAs of India and Pakistan are holding talks. If that is true, what was this chaperinch we were talking about and saying nothing doing till they stop terrorist activities from their soil? Are the talks on or not on? You allowed the ISI in Pathankot? What did we get back? You did the surgical strikes? The incidence of our soldiers dying, according to reports, has doubled after those surgical strikes. So what is the policy, sir? What is the policy you're adopting? And then you have this standoff with China today. Yes, I 100% agree with the government, and I told them that the best way that they have said that they will resolve this issue through diplomatic means and talks. Absolutely correct. But not only China. I want you to seriously consider. You had this year's Malabar exercises. Malabar. You know, sir, where Malabar is. It's in the Arabian Sea. What is the meaning of doing Malabar exercises in the Bay of Bengal? Is it geographical? Geographically also, are you correct? And in Bay of Bengal, you do Malabar exercises. With whom? With the USA and Japan. A joint naval military exercise with the United States of America, Japan and India. What does it signify to all these countries in Southeast Asia and South Asia? Joint military exercises are often done when two countries see or perceive a common enemy. Who is the common enemy between USA, Japan and India in the countries around the Bay of Bengal? And you don't think those countries understand these signals? One belt, one road. And Mr. Sasbude was there with me when he spoke today in the foreign policy thing, when the first meeting took place in Beijing on this issue. I proposed there a policy that what was followed by, then we were persuading the UPA government to follow, that if you have the Silk Road, which is what is sought to be revived now, you have the mirror image. If you fold the map of the world, the mirror image of the Silk Road is the maritime route, and that is what we have called the spice route. If you revive the Silk Road, then you revive the spice route, and both. आप चाहते हो कि दुनिया में हमारे इतने दोस्त है, हमारे दोस्त बहुत है. बताइए सर, कौन है? रूस कर लिया, रुकिए सुनिए, रूस कर लिया डिफेंस एग्रीमेंट पाकिस्तान के बाद, पहली बार देश की आज़ादी के बाद. दोस्त है आपके, दोस्त है रूस ने कर. अरे सुनिए ना, आप जिस तरीके से बिगाड़ रहे हो उधर.
नो प्लीज, लेट हिम से.
रूस जैसा जो हमारे साथी, हमारे दोस्त जो रहे हैं, जिसके बारे में आपने सुना, बांग्लादेश की लिबरेशन अगर वो हो ही नहीं सकती थी, संभव ही नहीं था अगर रूस की दोस्ती आपके साथ नहीं थी. और यूएसए की 7th फ्लीट जब पहुंची बे ऑफ बंगाल में, जो न्यूक्लियर सबमरीन उन्होंने जो उठ के दिखा दिया, उससे हो गए. तो आप दोस्त कह रहे हो वो सिर्फ, डोंट ड्रिंक दिस, आई हैव कंक्लूड. दोस्त कह रहे हो आप, वो सिर्फ जाने से दोस्ती नहीं होती, विदेश यात्राएं करके दोस्ती नहीं होती, ना गले मिलके ना टेलीविजन में दिखा के दोस्ती होती. सर, जुमलों से नहीं दोस्ती होती है. वास्तविकता क्या है, आपकी ताकत क्या है, आपकी अंदरूनी ताकत क्या है, और आप जिस तरीके से बिहेव कर रहे हो दुनिया के अंदर. अब ये कोई बता रहा था, ये अच्छा, माफी चाहता हूँ, मतलब बुरा ना माने, ये जोक के रूप में व्हाट्सएप में ये चल रहा है कि सुने कि आखिरी यात्रा में प्रधानमंत्री महोदय खिड़की से देखते हुए पायलट से कहा कि भाई ये कौन सी जगह है, बड़ा सुंदर है, यहाँ पे आना चाहिए। तो पायलट ने कहा कि सर ये तो हमारा ही देश है इंडिया। तो अब इससे दोस्ती नहीं बढ़ती। नहीं नहीं, वो क्योंकि बीच में ठोका
नहीं है,
नहीं है।
मैडम
ये बात कर लीजिए, एक बात सुन लीजिए, आप मुझे जानते हैं बड़े दिनों से।
नाउ यू हैव टू कंक्लूड आल्सो,
ये सब निकलता है एक्चुअली जी, बीच में अगर नहीं ठोकते
आप। नाउ यू हैव टू कंक्लूड आल्सो,
ना बीच
मैंने उन्हें रोक दिया, उसके बाद कहने की क्या बात। मैंने उन्हें स्वयं रोका ना,
आपने बता तब तक वो कह दिए,
मैंने रोका ना
तब तक वो कह दिए जो रोका।
क्या मत बोलिए, मैं
यू आर एचयूरी जी, यू आर मेकिंग ए सीरियस फेस, सो डोंट मेक इट लाइट।
नो, अब दैट लाइटनेस सर,
कीप इट,
That lightness was introduced only because of that intervention.
That I know, but
otherwise it wouldn't have come.
Don't be distracted by that.
Otherwise it wouldn't have come.
Yeah.
So my point, sir, is that you please look at our relations in our neighborhood. Good neighborly relations is the bedrock, should be the bedrock of our foreign policy. Look East policy was what we announced many years ago, that this government is also following. Just make a review,
okay,
of what is happening with all our neighbors and what is happening with our global standard. And please, for heaven's sake, our appeal to the government is, do not cement any US, Israel, India axis in world affairs.
Okay.
That is not in our country's interest. That is not in the interest of the support and allies that we
okay.
get. So with this, I would only wish the government would accept this with that sincere appeal. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Sri Dilip Kumar.